will follow you as the best example. You have better experience on this.
Labdien.
Good afternoon, and dear ladies and gentlemen, representatives of media and everyone watching us online, welcome to the Foreign Ministry. Welcome to the press conference following the meeting between the Slovenian and Latvian foreign ministers. We will start the press conference now. We'll start with the statement of the Latvian foreign minister. Good afternoon, dear colleagues. I do hope that I am comprehensible speaking through the mask. I hope you can understand what I'm saying. We indeed just had a meeting with my Slovenian colleague, Anže Logar. I am happy to underline that as we concluded, this is the first official visit of the Foreign Affairs Minister of Slovenia after a 10-year sort of pause. And we discussed a number of issues during this visit. We specifically talked about the second half of next year council presidency of Slovenia. We also discussed different issues linked to our bilateral foreign cooperation in the format of the EU, especially with regard to the enlargement of the EU and different priorities of the European Union. Secondly, we talked about the security agenda. I would like to thank my Slovenian colleague for Slovenia contributing its troops to the NATO EFP battle group stationed in Ardaje. Unfortunately, due to pandemic, we couldn't visit the camp Ardaje to meet with the Slovenian troops, but I'm absolutely certain that the better times are ahead of us and we will have the opportunity, and my colleague will have the opportunity to visit the camp Ardaje and meet with his troops. We also discussed a number of other priorities currently at the top of our agenda, namely the situation or the developments in Belarus. We also talked about issues linked to our cooperation in scope of the Three Seas initiative. We highly appreciate the recent virtual summit in Estonia and the web forum that was recently taking place in Estonia. We also talked about our cooperation when it comes to foreign policy of the EU, our cooperation in formulating common EU policy. We talked about China as well when we talked about bilateral relations between Slovenia and Latvia. We talked about trade cooperation, about other kinds of cooperation that we are very much interested in furthering in future. Would like to underline that considering the role of Slovenia in NATO, especially also the fact that Slovenia is preparing well in advance for its presidency in the latter half of next year, it's wonderful that this visit allowed us to talk about issues that are of a particular interest to both our countries when it comes to the EU. I think that there are two items at the top of our agenda currently. So the coordination with regard to fights against the COVID-19 pandemic, and the other topic on which we would like to very closely cooperate is taking decisions as soon as possible regarding the MFF and the availability of the recovery funding for the necessary economic interventions to mitigate the consequences of the pandemic. That's as far as introduction from me goes. I would like to stop here and would like to give the floor to my colleague for a brief statement. Thank you, and the floor is yours, Mr. Logar.
Thank you very much, Edward. I'm really glad to be here in Riga. Yes, it's true, it took us 10 years to come back here. You're more than welcome to return visit in Slovenia as well. I think in these difficult times of COVID-19, the cooperation and discussion should go on among capitals of the European Union as well as other member states. Especially for Slovenia, it's very important in light of preparation of our presidency in the second half of 2021. We are now in the final phase of preparation process, and on the EU level there are several dossiers that are extremely important and in a way divide and connect different capitals regarding the issue. We were discussing this today. I presented the priorities of Slovenian EU presidency. I tackled the most pertinent issues that are ahead of us. One was already mentioned, the question of multi-annual financial framework together with the recovery fund. We are now at a very important stage when the heads of state agreed in July this year to introduce a new financial measures to tackle the economic crisis caused by COVID-19. And now it's on us, on member state and on the EU institution, namely Council and Parliament, to agree on financial, process of starting the prospective and recovery fund as from 1st of January 2021. It is of utmost importance because our fellow nations, we depend on this money, the recovery depends on this money, our fellow citizens expect this for us to do. There are many of member states that already presented and prepared the programs to use European money for building more resilient system. And we have the role of us politicians is to deliver. The second question that is very important ahead of us is the new migration and asylum pact. So the revision of Dublin Directive. On 23rd of September, European Commission presented its draft plan. Slovenia joined the V4 and Baltic state in a letter how to address this issue. And this is going to be extremely important topic during German presidency that I guess as well the Portuguese presidency will succeed the discussion. I hope they will conclude, otherwise it's on the agenda of Slovenian EU presidency. Then is a question of Convention for the Future of Europe. Slovenia and Latvia have more or less the same position on that sense. German presidency is currently drafting the mandate with in dialogue with the European Parliament, and it's up to them that find the conclusion and the adoption until the end of this year. And during Slovenian presidency, there will be some major event regarding this issue. And there is as well two questions that are more or less related to, location where Slovenia is, the enlargement process of the Western Balkan state and the dialogue of Belgrade-Pristina. We recently discussed this issue on Foreign Affairs Committee by the, proposal of five member states coming from Central Europe, that we see it's a very important issue and we need this talks on the agenda of European Union. And I'm glad what I had today from my counterpart Edgars, that the position of Latvia is more or less identical to ours. So I'm concluding this visit in, a very friendly manner, and I look forward for thorough cooperation. We exchange some other issues as well, in relation to China, relation to Russia, and as well the question of political development in Belarus and the importance of transatlantic cooperation. Slovenia and Latvia are two member states with more or less the same size and the same political orientation, and I think this is a very good starting point to enhance our cooperation, and I'm sure that it won't last another 10 years to meet again either in Slovenia or here in Riga.
Lielas paldies.
Thank you. We have time for a couple of questions. I would like to give the floor now to Uģis Lībietis, a correspondent of the Latvian Radio, for the first question. Please, the floor is yours.
It's from Latvian Radio. I have a question for Minister regarding the fight against the COVID-19 in Slovenia. We know that pretty strong curfew has been introduced in Slovenia, and probably you can share what is the main challenges and lessons you have learned from fight with epidemics in your country. The second question is a little bit somehow connected with this one about this recovery funding, which will be available in the future. There are lots of discussions with European Parliament about this financing being tied to the rule of law in some countries, and especially in also in your neighboring countries. What is the Slovenia's position and regarding these requirements from European Parliament side? Thank you.
Apparently this was question only for me. Yes, Slovenia is facing a very severe second wave of pandemic COVID-19. The spread infection is, very high. There's a steep curve in that sense, and the Slovenian government took its decision we called epidemic. That means that according to this law, we can adopt several measures that had its basement in this law, and we will do our utmost to, constrain the spread of the virus. But in that sense, it's very important that our fellow citizens are respecting these confinement measures. It is for their health, and my appeal would be not to behave in a manner that this possibility of spread of the virus is lowered to the minimum. It's a very tough period. Longer it takes, there will be a bigger toll on the health system and as well on the economy. So it is in our all interest to be very cautious regarding that. If we talk about financial perspective and the recovery fund. So the head of state in July summit agreed to financial framework that enable EU member state to have this, safety cushion of EU fund in order to tackle the consequences of COVID-19. And now it's on the institutions of European Union and as well member state to make progress and make live what was agreed on the July summit. In that sense, there is a question of conditionality, but I think it's of utmost importance that the institution and the member state agreed on it, that do not politicize this issue, because it is the future of EU and member states at stake. I cannot imagine the failure of this talks for the future of European Union as well, for the, all the projects that were already designated in member state, especially in those that were the most affected, Spain, Italy, with the pandemic. So I think all interlocutors now should bear in mind that this agreement among the institution and member state is a key priority for the future 2 months in order that we make this basics for building a robust European Union that is prepared for the crisis like this.
Liels paldies. Ar to mēs...
Thank you. This concludes our joint press conference. Thank you all for participation. Thank you, ministers. Thank you.